to this talk on the faculty talk series. Tonight we have Maria Zuber, and we've had a few of these talks so far, and there's a few more after this. So really the point of this whole series is for students to get to hear from a faculty member about how they became a professor, and also just to hear something about their personal story. It makes more of a sort of personal connection with them. So I'm Laurie Gibson, I'm in the materials department, and I do this as the last lecture in my class every term. I have a version of this talk, and my students really like it. And I thought other people would like to hear from other faculty, and so I've been inviting just faculty that I know that I thought would have an interesting story to give these talks. So tell me, you have Maria. And I'm going to give you Maria's official MIT biography.
Uh-oh.
And she's going to tell you the story behind that.
Okay.
So this is what it has on her website. Maria Zuber is the E.A. Griswold Professor of Geophysics, and she's the Vice President of Research at MIT. So she's one of the senior administrators at MIT. Her research focuses on the structure and tectonics of solid solar system objects. She specializes in using gravity and laser altimetry measurements to determine interior structure and evolution, and has been involved in more than half a dozen NASA planetary missions aimed at mapping the Moon, Mars, Mercury, as well as several asteroids. She was principal investigator for the Gravity Recovery and Interior Laboratory, GRAIL, and as such has became the first woman to lead a NASA spacecraft mission. Maria received her BA in Astronomy and Geology from the University of Pennsylvania. She also earned a master's and PhD degree in geophysics from Brown University. She later worked at Johns Hopkins and served as a research scientist at the NASA Goddard Space Flight Center in Maryland. She joined the faculty of MIT in 1995, where as chair of the Department of Earth, Atmospheric, and Planetary Sciences between 2003 and 2012, she became the first woman to lead a science department at MIT. Okay, Maria, that's all yours.
Thank you. Okay, so this is success is random. Okay, so first of all, I loved space. I study space. I always loved space, and the only thing I ever wanted to do was study space. Okay, and so this is a picture, the first color image from Viking Lander 1 that came back. And when I was little, I was sitting at home having breakfast, and the newspaper was delivered with the first color picture of Mars from Viking Lander 1, and you know, my father shows me this photograph, you know, front page, you know, and he says, "All right, Maria, we've been to Mars. What are you gonna do now?" Okay, and so my answer to him, okay, was, "Just watch." Okay, so this talk is really about what happened out of just watch. Okay, all right, so the story begins. This is a geological map of Pennsylvania, and here's where I grew up. This is Summit Hill, Pennsylvania, which is in anthracite country. So this is where, in fact, this is the town where anthracite coal was discovered in eastern Pennsylvania. Okay, so that is where I grew up. So here's a nice monument in the park commemorating the discovery of anthracite coal. And here are some pictures of my town. Okay, was a little bit before I was growing up, but the mines were still burning when I was growing up. And my father grew up in this town. My mother grew up in a nearby town, okay, but the house that she lived in started falling into the mines, so she had to move out of it. And so so she moved up to this town and met my father. And then here I am. Okay. All right. So these are my parents. Okay. Neither one of my parents went to high school, or they went to college. They both went to high school. My mother was a part-time reading aide, and my father was a state policeman. And in the town where I lived, he was one of the highest paid people in town as a policeman. Okay, so a lot of socioeconomic challenges associated with growing up in that part of the world. These are my brothers and sisters. I was the oldest of five children. None of them are like me. I was like an alien dropped into, you know, Earth. That's okay, it's true. This right here, so this is me, and this is my my mother's father and mother, okay? Both my grandfathers were coal miners. They both worked in the mines. They both had black lung, and they both died associated with complications associated with working in the mines, okay? You know, the whole deal of fossil fuels is something that is a very personal thing for me, as you could imagine. And in fact, one of the things I'm doing right now is working on MIT's response to climate change. And for me, this was you know, something that I very much wanted to do to help the Institute find a path forward on this. So we're going to come back and talk about my grandfather here in a second, my mother's father, because he was a very important person in my life. And here I am with my wonderful husband, Jack, and my son, my oldest son, Jack. I have another son, Jordan, that you'll see a picture of in a minute. So we'll come back to my grandfather in a minute. But I grew up building telescopes. That's what I did. I designed these things. It was all self-taught. I ground my own lenses. I taught myself optics. I found a high school physics book, and I taught myself optics. And I built these telescopes. And when I was growing up, I spent a huge amount of time with my grandfather, and he used to help me in my telescope building studying. Studying the skies outside, you know, I used to stay out for hours and hours and hours. I've gotten frostbite on my face from, you know, looking in the telescope. I don't know why people do that, but it had to be done. And I always thought that my grandfather had spent a lot of time with me because he loved me, which, you know, I'm sure he did. But I didn't find out until after he died. He had quit school when he was in eighth grade to go work in the mines to help support his family, and he got to keep a little bit of the money that he raised for himself, and he bought himself a telescope with the money that he saved working in the mines, and so. So I think a lot, actually, about you know, all the things that didn't get discovered or didn't get discovered soon because he didn't get the chance to go to college like I got the chance to go to college. You know, that was something that so it really factors into my thinking a lot about you know, the importance of financial aid and the importance of opportunity for everybody to be able to go to college who has a passion. Okay, so I went to Panther Valley High School. Let's see, I'm the first person to get a PhD, male or female, from that high school. I then went to the University of Pennsylvania. So because no one ever went to college in my family, you know, when I went to apply to college, my father thought any college was college, right? And so he wanted me to go to the Penn State Extension campus that was about 15 miles from my house. And so I started applying for scholarships so that I could, if I got a scholarship, maybe I could at least go up to the Penn State main campus. And so I applied for something called a senatorial scholarship, which provided a scholarship to attend the state university. And someone in the senator's office saw my application and called my guidance counselor and said, you know what, she doesn't belong in Penn State, she belongs in the Ivy League, so tell her to apply to the University of Pennsylvania. So I applied to the University of Pennsylvania. I got in 2 weeks. You know, I didn't understand, it was the only place I applied. I didn't understand all this about doing all this college stuff like you guys had to do. So I went to Penn and then went to Brown University after that. I had a really great experience. I got a great education at both places. So then after I graduated, I met my husband at Penn, and he said, and he was getting his MBA while I was finishing my PhD, and he said, give me five cities where you might be able to get a job. So I gave him five cities, and he was an MBA. He got offers in all five cities, okay? And then he said, all right, why don't you go work for NASA and get this out of your system, right? Because if you don't work for NASA, you're always going to regret that you didn't work for NASA. So go to NASA, you know. So I went there, and then, I had just fantastic opportunities there. But, NASA was the government. And so, in any job that you have in life, maybe you're lucky if you spend half your time doing, what you want to do, and then the other half of your time you spend, serving your institution in some way, shape, or form. So when I was at NASA, they made me monitor contracts, okay, which wasn't too interesting. So I volunteered to teach a course at Johns Hopkins. Just at night, I wasn't allowed to do it on official government time. And I realized that if I was going to spend half of my time, I really wanted to spend it teaching and working with students. So I went there, and then I wound up coming to MIT, and we'll kind of talk about how that happens soon. Okay, I did a theoretical PhD thesis, and when I was coming out of grad school, I went to NASA, and it was at the time when Ronald Reagan was president and had the Strategic Defense Initiative going, where they were shooting, laser instruments, and then I just thought to myself, okay, well, if we're spending billions of dollars on laser technology, there's got to be something useful in that somewhere. Okay, so I got all my security clearances, and with some other people, declassified one of these laser systems to the point where, it's all power pointing stability. So I just dialed all those down, with the help of some really talented engineers, and made everything so that it was just not classified. Okay, I won an instrument to go to Mars the year after I got out of grad school. Okay, because the performance just blew everything else away that existed, and so that was good. Okay, and we were off to a good start, but then the Challenger blew up, and that caused a delay in the system, what had originally gone was that there was a radar on this spacecraft, and after Challenger blew up, it sent the whole NASA program into disarray, and that was when it opened it up so that we were able to propose this thing, and they picked it. So I had an instrument to go to Mars. Unfortunately, this spacecraft, Mars Observer, was lost 3 days before it got to Mars. So I went from, being this sort of promising theoretical person to this fantastic, you want an instrument that went to Mars, to this instrument just disappearing. I'll tell you, my education prepared me to succeed, but my education didn't really prepare me to fail, because I had never really failed before. And although I still have nightmares about this, to tell you the truth, it was probably the best thing that ever happened to me in my career, because I lost my fear, okay? I just set my threshold for something being a problem was, if it's worse than losing your spacecraft 3 days from Mars, then it's really horrible. Other than that, it'll be okay, all right? And so it set me free, okay, I guess is the way to say it. And lost my fear, okay? So actually, after that was lost, I just completely bummed out for a while. And then I was the youngest person on the mission, and there was another young person on the mission, and his name was Steve Squires, who was the head of the Mars Rovers Opportunity and Spirit. And Steve and I went down to Congress to ask for a new Mars mission, and we got it, okay? And so that kind of opened my eyes as to the power of articulating science. And so we got a new mission called Mars Global Surveyor. And then success breeds success. And then we competitively won all these different proposals. So a lot of people keep pictures of their children in their wallet. I do that too. But I also keep pictures of my instruments. So this was, we flew this once, we flew it twice. And the second time we flew it to Mars, it was, it was so much better, and I was so much better prepared to take advantage of what happened there. So we measured the topography of Mars. It's known, the topography of Mars when we measured it was known better than the topography of Earth. In fact, I was sitting on an airplane flying down to Washington, and I had the cover of Science, where our map had made the cover, and this guy said, "Oh, you should read that article. You know, these people mapped Mars, you know, better than mapped the Earth, for just a fraction of what it takes the DOD to map that." And it's amazing. And I said, "Oh, you want a reprint?" And I, opened my briefcase up and pulled out a reprint. And I says, "Yeah, that was our experiment." And he says, "People in the Pentagon were fired when this paper was published." So that was cool. Okay. So this is a cross section of the map of Mars going from the South Polar Cap up to the North Pole of Mars. So you could actually, what you could see here is that all the it's all downhill, okay, in one direction. And so so my research was a Jeopardy question, okay. On Jeopardy, they asked the question, which direction did the water flow on Mars, okay, and it's north, okay. So you know you've made it when your research becomes a Jeopardy question, okay. So that came out of that. We always thought about doing really simple things. And in fact, when I went down to Congress to ask them about, please give us a new mission to Mars, I said, "We will be able to do weather reports on Mars. We're going to be able to measure the weather on Mars. People will love this, okay?" And I says, "If you don't think this is great, go home and ask your kids if they think it's a great idea." So they must have done that, because it all worked out. So we shot lasers into the atmosphere on Mars, and we measured, this is dry ice snow. So on Mars, Mars is made of, has a carbon dioxide atmosphere, and when it gets dark, it snows. And we were able to actually map the snow on Mars in the atmosphere. And you could never take a picture of this because it's dark, okay? But we had a laser, so we had our own illumination. And this is a plot of elevation as a function of latitude. So here we're going from 60 degrees up to the pole in the north and south hemisphere. So this is actually snowfall. This is the snow depth on Mars. And we were the first group to measure snow depth from a satellite, and we actually made this measurement before it was made on Earth. Okay, so not long after we published this for Mars, they finally figured out how to measure snow depth from a satellite on the Earth. So, and the year we made this measurement, Mars got less snow that year than Boston. Okay, so, and last winter Mars really got less snow than Boston, but it was possible to measure that. And then, you know, I don't want to get too technical here, but this is just kind of, you know, honestly, everything I do is because I want to know and I'm interested in doing this. So, you know, Mars, the tilt of Mars's axis is about the same as the Earth's, and so Mars undergoes seasons, and so you get the snow in the northern hemisphere winter, and then and so it ablates off the southern hemisphere, and then the other winter it goes down, and so it changes the flattening of the planet by a part in a billion. Okay, so if you can measure the change in the flattening of Mars, you could actually track the CO2 cycle. You can quantitatively track the CO2 exchange in the atmosphere, and we did that, so that was pretty interesting. And so an interesting trivia question for you: the mass exchanged in 1 year in carbon dioxide from one pole to the other on Mars is almost the same as the mass of Mars's moon Phobos, okay? And the reason that I know that is that if you don't solve for the mass of Phobos when you do this calculation, you can't get the right answer. And so I learned that the hard way. It took a lot longer for this to happen than it should have. So those are some of the kind of research things that I was doing. By this time, I was at MIT, and I was in Earth Atmospheric and Planetary Sciences, or EAPS, great, great, great group of colleagues, and I had several missions finishing up, and I decided I was going to do a sabbatical. So I went to the Radcliffe Institute for Advanced Study of Harvard, so two T stops away, okay, and everyone said, don't go to Harvard for a sabbatical because you'll be coming back all the time for something or other. And so what I did is I set a day for my sabbatical to start, and I made an appointment with my department head at noon. Okay, my sabbatical was going to start at noon. I made an appointment with my department head at 11:30. I went and I sat down with him and I said, if you call me back, it better be so important that I'm willing to go to Logan Airport, get on an airplane, fly all the way around the Earth, and come back to Logan Airport to come back to the department. Okay, and you know, everyone laughed at me when I did this. Okay, but then, I got this phone call at home one night saying, and I just, everything that came in from MIT, I just deleted it the whole year. And so I got this phone call at night saying, you know what, the dean's been trying to get in touch with you and you're not returning any of his emails. And would you please go talk to the dean? And so they made me department head while I was gone. So never take a sabbatical the year that they're looking for a new department head. So I had to cut my sabbatical short and go back, but had the privilege of leading my department, which I did for about 8.5 years. And while that was going on, I got the opportunity to team with a group of wonderful people and propose a NASA space mission, and it was called GRAIL, for the Gravity Recovery and Interior Laboratory. So it's two spacecraft flying and doing formation flying over the surface of the moon to measure the gravity field really precisely. And so this is a map of the moon before GRAIL. And actually, this gravity field not quite this good. This is what got me tenure at MIT. Okay, hadn't been measured before like this, measured it, And then, well, we always try to do better. So so we cleaned it up and did that. And so that was pretty gratifying. At the same time, we flew another instrument to measure the topography of the moon. And this is another one of our laser altimeters. And actually came up with the really interesting finding. Here's a topography map, and here's a gravity map. And they look almost identical at small scales. And this actually showed that nearly all the small scale gravity on the moon is due to topography. And this actually is a statement that there's no mass anomalies in the crust of the moon. And this was a proof or a statement that the crust of the moon is pulverized from impacts. And so this was a pretty revolutionary result. So so at about this time, I had just stepped down as head of my department because I wanted to fly my two spacecraft around the moon, and Raphael Reif became president, and he called me in, and I'd had a pretty good year scientifically, and he said, all right, you know, time to do something new, and I can give you something to do that'll be a bigger budget than GRAIL, okay? And GRAIL was a $500 million budget, and he's very persuasive. So if he ever calls you to come and talk to him, think about if you want to do that, because he's probably going to ask you to do something. So so I became vice president for research, but have kept my own research going, because it's really important to do research. And we've been doing a whole variety of things. So we in addition to the science, we try to prove laser technology. So we did the first two-way laser link it was 13 million kilometers from a spacecraft that was coming back to do an Earth encounter. We hold the record for the longest distance that a laser beam ever has been fired and detected. So we shot a laser from Earth and actually detected it in Mars orbit. And then my favorite is we did the first interplanetary laser communication experiment. We digitized the Mona Lisa and beamed it up to the moon. Okay, so just for fun, okay, and so we did we did all kinds of encoding and everything to make it work. So so to me, it's all about enjoying what you do. So things that are really important to me. My family is the most important thing to me. Here are my two boys. Jordan graduated from MIT. Jack graduated from Brown and Columbia grad school. And actually, Jack's undergraduate roommate, is here today. My teammates, my colleagues and my students and postdocs and research scientists in my group. I think the only thing I really do well is identify talent and find the best people to work with, because I can't actually do all that much. I love to command instruments and spacecraft. I really love to do that. And things go wrong all the time. I mean, you don't hear about them, but things go wrong all the time. And I wish nothing ever went wrong, but I love the problem-solving aspect of fixing something that you can't touch. I love rockets. When I'm launching something, I'm down at the launch pad like every day. Most people will show up like once. I would show up every day because I like to be around rockets so much. I love to do field work. I travel, get the opportunity to travel all over the place in scientific endeavors. So this one here, that was about 2 years ago. And I asked our president, I said, I have the chance to go to Antarctica, can I go? And he went, if I don't let you go, you'll quit, and then I'll be in trouble. So get your picture taken with a penguin. So we actually had to divert a helicopter to the edge of the Ross ice sheet here to find some penguins to get our picture taken with, okay? And I just love to talk about science to anybody. So I do a lot of outreach with students, politicians. This is Neil Armstrong and Gene Cernan, the first and last people to walk on the moon, and I got to testify before Congress with them. So the message here, I mean, this is the end, and I'm happy to open it up for questions then. I mean, the message here really is that if you study hard and you really think about what you enjoy doing and decide on a career that allows you to enjoy what you do, you can just have a wonderful, wonderful life, okay? And you know, all of you are privileged to be at this great institution, and you're going to have lots of choices. So think really hard about of what's going to be personally fulfilling and what's going to make you happy. And I'll stop right there.
You're still the kid with the telescope. You're still the kid building the telescope. It's just on a bigger scale, that's all. So does anybody have questions?
So, fantastic talk, by the way. I've seen that at some point you showed the Star Wars logo. You were influenced by Star Wars. Why Star Wars and not Star Trek?
Oh, well, that was, so Star Wars was the nickname for the Strategic Defense Initiative. So that was why Star Wars was there. But I have every Star Trek episode, so, and every Star Wars movie. Okay, so fear not.
Uh-huh.
I can't believe it. So, yeah.
I for some reason, I feel like science is growing more and more competitive as decades pass. And do you have any advice for the next generation of scientists for how to deal with the staggering amount of competition that's coming out from around the world?
Yeah. So I'll tell you what. A lot of science is becoming really compartmentalized. Somebody's got a bunch of people competing to find the same gene, you know. What I love about this field that I'm in is you got the whole solar system out there. And if it works, you're set. And if it doesn't work, it's horrible. You know, I mean, there's no, you just do another experiment. I mean, this is, you know, the reason MIT hired, I was an untenured junior professor at Johns Hopkins, and the reason MIT hired me as a full professor, okay, when I was a junior professor without tenure, and when I asked them why, they said, when that spacecraft blew up, you should have gone away and disappeared, and you didn't, and we're betting that's not a mistake. And so for me, it's always been a kind of a risk reward thing. So there's no reason to believe that, you know, some person just coming out of grad school could win an instrument to go to Mars. But it never occurred to me not to try, right? I mean, I could have done a lot of things that were a lot safer to do, and that would have led to a perfectly good career. But I decided to really go for it, and then you know, I mean, it seemed like a good idea at the time, and then it seemed like a really, really bad idea, right? But then it turned out to be a good idea again. So the competition is you know, it is certainly getting to be more competitive. There's no question about that. But you know, think about why are you doing this? Okay, so that you know, that was a question that I always asked myself. So when you know, when that spacecraft blew up, you know, I sat there in my office, looking out my window into the woods for a long time, thinking about where I was at and what I was going to do next, and I came to the conclusion that you know, if I wasn't willing to redo that now, why did I do it in the first place? Because you know, something is either worth doing or it's not, and your life is short enough. You know, I mean, you don't know how long your life is, but in your life, you should, you know, everything you do should be one of the most important things to you. Okay, and if it isn't one of the most important things, then you should, you know, try a few things to sort of find what your passion is. But you know, but you shouldn't spend your time doing things, you know, just to do them, right? So, I mean, it's all right to move around and sort of try some things, but you know, you figure out what you're good at, right? And so, I mean, a lot of people think, oh, I want to go be an academic professor, right? Because you did this PhD and you learned how to do lab experiments and you learned how to TA, ergo, I should be, you know, you go down that path. But there's, you know, there's a lot of really, really interesting paths that you could follow. And I kind of felt, okay, well, I left a permanent staff position at NASA to take an untenured faculty position at Johns Hopkins, and I gave my job talk when I was 8 months pregnant and left a permanent staff job to go do that. And they hired me, right? Which, you know, still amazes me. But I just kind of said, okay, well, you know, if this doesn't work out, you know, we'll try something else. You know, we'll think of something else. So I think the key is really thinking about something that's really meaningful to you, and giving it a shot. And you know, a lot of things that I have tried really have not worked out. But you know, you don't need that many things to work out. So, you know, so.
Other questions?
Yeah.
What's your balance between long-term vision and kind of reacting to opportunities as they come?
So you know, I've always, so in my mind, I have a bunch of what I call trophies that I'd like to have on my mantelpiece, okay? And some of them have been in my mind for decades and may never be realized. Okay, but as a general rule, when I decide to kind of go for something, you know, I'm always thinking about getting, you know, an instrument on the top of a rocket in 5 years. Okay, that's so I operate on 5 year. Kind of time frames. You know, I mean, I do some things that are kind of longer term, you know, and that's probably about maybe 20% of what I do, but you know, most of what I do is on a 5 year time frame. So I, you know, there are a lot of people who their whole career has been one mission, right? And you know, I was, you know, so I never thought of like what's the most sophisticated thing that I could do. My goal was always what is the least sophisticated thing that I can do that will get me into space, right? Because, I mean, you saw that lousy moon map, right? That got me tenure at MIT, okay? Because no one had made that kind of map before, okay? But then I was unsatisfied with that. But it was good enough, and that was a DOD mission. It wasn't a NASA mission, and it was a mission to test Star Wars sensors, right? It wasn't a mission to study planets. So most people in the science community wouldn't go near that mission because the low quality of the instruments for scientific observation. But you know, to me, whenever you look at something that hasn't been looked at before, right, you're going to discover something. And it never fails. I mean, when you look at something at a new spectral wavelength, or you know, at a higher resolution, or with a new technique, you always, always discover something. So I'm a huge fan of discovery science. So I kind of look at, when's the technology going to allow me to just look at something in a new way? And that's how I kind of do the near-term stuff.
Yeah, I was just wondering, as you advance in your career and take up new positions and new missions and sort of continue to climb upwards, have you found it more difficult to sort of balance that with the other things that are important to you in your life?
Oh, yeah. So actually, one thing that I'm pretty good at is that I don't do a lot of second guessing. Okay, I mean, so there are some people where you have a baby. Okay, and you know, every time you're at work, and you keep thinking you should be at home with the baby, right? And when you're home with the baby, you keep thinking you should be at work, right? Don't do that, right? You know, I mean, so, you know, I'd say, all right, well, I'm gonna leave the office at 3 o'clock, and then I'm gonna, you know, hopefully put the baby to bed at 9 o'clock, and then I'm gonna start working again, and this is the way we're gonna do it. And, you know, revisit that occasionally to see it's working, but don't obsess about am I doing the right thing. So if I had to do it all again, I've had the main thing I think was with raising kids. So I actually raised my my two boys. I actually sat them down at one point and I said, all right, you know, I'm doing what I'm doing. Should I be, you know, staying home more with you guys, or you know, is it all okay? And one of my sons went, Mom, are you kidding? You're like the only mother in the class who shoots lasers in space, you know. the year I took sabbatical, I went to every single activity, and you know, after a while, you know, the kids were saying, Mom, go write a paper, you know? I mean, enough. So you kind of, you know, you sort of reach this equilibrium, and, you know, and you know, kids are pretty resilient, so you find this kind of normal level. But you kind of got to keep an eye on things and just make sure that everything is going okay, and then if an adjustment is necessary, make an adjustment. And you know, there have been times where I have had to make an adjustment. You know, if my kids were still home right now with what I'm doing right now, I don't know what I would do. All right, but I'm in the stage of my career right now where I can be in a sort of crazy sort of situation now in terms of time commitment. So.
I remember a few days ago, there was some the news that NASA said about the water in Mars. Yeah. Did you know that about?
Oh yeah. Yeah. So I've been on the editorial board of Science since 1999, and so I see a lot of things before they come out. But yeah. On that one, even if I hadn't known about it, just knowing what the observation was, I would have known about it, because everyone knows that, who's working on what. So yeah, but it's a fantastic discovery. So.
Did you ever have any passion for anything but this type of stuff? It sounds like when you were a little kid, this really turned you on. And did you ever, like, I have students who come to me and say, well, you know, I can't decide if I want to do this or I want to do that, because they can't.
No, for me,
but
no.
But for you, it sounds like, no. Man, this was it for baby.
No, that was it, yeah. No. And, you know, I mean, I remember at my high school graduation, my calculus teacher, who loved me, you know, says, Maria, no one ever gets a job in astrophysics, you know. And I went, well, who wants to work, right? I just want to study space, right? I'll be fine. And so I, you know, I think being oblivious, there's a lot to be said for being oblivious. So because if I had thought about it, you know, actually the employees, you know, employment statistics for astronomers actually, you know, it wasn't that high, I guess. But I always felt like if you really, really want to do it, you'll figure out some way to do it. It may be a circuitous path, or it may take you a while. But if you're really, really, really committed, you know, if only 10% get jobs, and I don't know what the statistics is, then you know you got to work harder than the other 90%, and then you'll be in that, you know, that top 10%. And so it's a question of just how much it means to you. So for me, there was never a doubt.
Obviously, then you were also very good at identifying mentors to sort of follow.
Yeah.
Do you have any advice for identifying good mentors along your career?
Yeah. So I had, you know, I had people looking out for me, you know, in my whole career, and actually all men. Okay. So I never had anyone that I would consider to be a female mentor, actually, until Susan Hockfield became president, and then I got to know Susan. What happens is that you, you know, you're a young and up and coming person, and so, you know, you get to be the junior person on blank, okay, and so they always pick a junior person or two to serve on whatever. And that person is there to do all the work, okay? And that's great as long as you get credit for it in the appropriate sense. And it doesn't mean being the first author on the paper or anything, but it could just mean, you know, someday, we're gonna recall that Maria did all the work on this, and you know she's gonna get her due. And you can kind of figure out when people are there to help you with your career and not, okay? And so that's what you sort of have to look out for, you know? I mean, it's, you know, for a lot of reasons, you know, somebody can't be first author or PI on something, but you know, you're providing, you know, an opening into opportunities that wouldn't be possible otherwise. And so, you know, so you look for people who kind of care about developing talent. I mean, I've always sort of looked at this like, you know, I'm as proud of, you know, the people who came out of my group and have gone on to succeed as I am for anything that I've ever done myself. And I've actually done very little by myself, right? I mean, it's everything that I've done has been, you know, in collaboration with other people. And there's plenty of credit to go around. You know, you never lose by giving other people credit. So.
Well, let's thank Maria again. Okay. I'd just like to close by thanking the Chancellor's Office for sponsoring this event. Another talk next week, on October 28th. Paula Hammond, who's the department head in chemical engineering, will be giving a talk, give her version of this. So if any of you are interested in that, please come. It's in the same room, same time, 2 weeks. So thanks again, Ray.